Senator of the United States. It will be the greatest foreign policy challenge the United States faces in the decades to come. The policies of the Chinese Communist Party undermine U.S. interests and values, including those we share with allies and partners around the world. COVID-19 has brought this challenge to the forefront of American life. We now know just how much the Chinese Communist Party's decisions and actions directly affect U.S. citizens, our allies and partners, and the entire world. And we know not even a global pandemic will stop China's aggressive behavior, whether that's in Hong Kong, the South China Sea, or the Indian border. Over the last 3 years, the Trump administration has taken numerous steps to put the United States on a stronger path to competing with China. Last week, I was glad to see long overdue sanctions on Chinese Communist Party officials for human rights abuses in Tibet and elsewhere. I was also pleased that we declared China's claims in the South China Sea as unlawful and deployed two carrier battle groups there for exercises. And after the Chinese Communist Party crushed Hong Kong's autonomy, the president made the tough but necessary decision to end certain types of special treatment for Hong Kong. In May, the administration published a report on the implementation of its China strategy that goes into more detail. So this is a good time for this committee to conduct oversight regarding our objectives, what we've done, and where we go from here. This is also an opportunity to discuss China legislation put forward by members of this committee and others. This week, I introduced the Strengthening Trade, Regional Alliances, Technology, Economic, and Geopolitical Initiatives Concerning China, or the Strategic Act. It is a comprehensive approach to China with concrete policies in several key areas of the competition. I'll describe some of them briefly. We must continue our focus on China's anti-competitive economic policies. The Chinese government engages in intellectual property theft and massive financing of Chinese companies. And the most abusive anti-free market tactic of forced technology. This is a horrible practice. Forced technology transfer. This is a horrible practice. It's reprehensible. These policies are designed to push others out of the market and create monopolies. Innovative American companies like Micron Technologies, based in my home state of Idaho, know these challenges well. Their intellectual property was stolen by a Chinese company who then patented that technology in China and sued Micron. The Strategic Act authorizes new tools for U.S. companies to address the harms caused by such policies, among several other provisions. To maintain our economic and technological edge, it's not enough to just push back on what China is doing. We also have to strengthen and invest in ourselves. In other committees, I have focused on this issue by supporting legislation promoting U.S. manufacturing of critical technologies, fortifying cybersecurity for our infrastructure and small businesses, and strengthening our technology workforce. The Strategic Act focuses on increasing technology collaboration with allies and partners. America is the world hub for innovation, and we can boost that innovation further by working with our highly capable partners. If we do, we will all be in a better position to develop the technologies of the future and ensure they are used to uphold individual freedom, human rights, and prosperity. Finally, I want to stress the importance of deterrence. The United States, of course, does not seek any sort of military confrontation with China. However, China's military is getting bigger, more capable, and becoming more aggressive. In the Indo-Pacific region, we should all be a lot more worried about the Chinese Communist Party's plans for Taiwan, given what it just did to Hong Kong. In addition to the South China Sea, Japan faces almost daily incursions and pressure in the East China Sea. Beyond the region, China's Belt and Road Initiative is also helping the Chinese military expand its presence. We have to make it completely clear to the Chinese Communist Party that we are willing and able to defend our interests. That means reaffirming our commitments to our Indo-Pacific allies, even as they need to take on a larger role in defending the interests we share. The Strategic Act focuses on key steps for advancing defense cooperation with our allies, including advocating for several difficult but important policy changes. I want to stress that this bill that I've introduced does not seek to block China. Rather, what it does is it offers prosperity. It offers an invitation to join the international community and operate under the rule of law and under international norms. If that happens, we all will prosper. We should not miss the bipartisan opportunity that we have today to address these things. I'll close with a note about bipartisanship. Time and time again, on everything from human rights to investment screening, the Senate has worked across the aisle on China. Unfortunately, in recent months, that has become a lot harder. We have a long road ahead of us in this competition. We cannot allow partisanship to get in the way, even in an election year. Whatever happens in November, China will remain an issue. If we do not work together, the United States as a whole will be weaker. I introduce this bill to push forward a serious and bipartisan conversation about the Senate's role in advancing an effective strategy of competition. I want to thank several of my colleagues on this committee from both sides of the aisle in joining me on that effort. There is both Republican and Democrat input into this bill, not only from this committee, also from the think tanks around Washington, D.C., including Democrat think tanks. And I hope this will be the start of more cooperation to come. When we get to a final bill, I'm very hopeful that that bill will contain items that everyone has an interest in. There's been a number of people that have introduced bills. I know the ranking member is about to introduce a bill. I have no doubt that there'll be things in there that we can all embrace. And I hope as we get to a final bill, we will have things that we can embrace on a bipartisan basis. With that, I'll turn it over to the ranking member, Senator Menendez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Secretary Biegun, my thanks for joining us here today, especially as it's been so long since we've had a senior administration witness before the committee. As you and I have discussed in the past, I think the administration is asking the right questions about China and the U.S.-China relationship. Unfortunately, however, I find that the administration's strategies and policies fall well short of answering the enormity of the challenge. We need instead, as the title of this hearing suggests, an effective China strategy. The China of 2020 is not the China of 1972 or even the China of 2000 or 2010. China today is challenging the United States across every dimension of power: political, diplomatic, economic, innovation, military, even cultural, and with an alternative and deeply disturbing model for global governance. China today, led by the Communist Party and propelled by Xi Jinping, hypernationalism is unlike any challenge we have faced as a nation before. Emboldened by the retrenchment, shortcomings, and sometimes enablement of the Trump administration, China today is more active and more assertive in the region and in the international community than ever before. Indeed, just since this past March, China has increased its patrols near the Senkaku Islands in the East China Sea, as well as its coercive activities in the South China Sea, conducted air and maritime patrols intended to threaten Taiwan, clashed with India along the actual line of control, the People's Liberation Army's first use of force abroad in 30 years, continued to implement a morally repugnant campaign of genocide in Xinjiang, its cruel oppression of the Tibetan people, and the crushing of its own civil liberty. Just yesterday, I released a report, The New Big Brother, looking at how China has stepped up its game in seeking to export a new model of digital authoritarianism and manipulate new technologies to control its own citizens and people worldwide. But aside from bluster rhetoric and some hastily written sanctions, what has the response been from the administration? The administration is now taking strong action on Hong Kong, but for months when the people of Hong Kong needed us, the president was silent and complicit in China's erosion of Hong Kong's autonomy, happy to trade Hong Kong for his so-called trade deal. Along with the chairman, I welcome regular freedom of navigation assertions and the administration's recent clarification of our approach to claims in the South China Sea. But the reality is that over the past 3 years, China's aggression and coercion in the South China Sea has continued completely unchecked. The United Kingdom's change of policy on Huawei, while welcomed, was, I would suggest, despite us, not because of us. And on trade and economics, this administration has walked away from building regional architecture, embraced a so-called phase one trade deal, which seemingly achieves nothing, certainly does not address the core structural issues in the relationship, and leaves us, in the words of your own U.S. trade representative, wondering what the end goal of your trade policy is. And if he doesn't know, then we all have a real problem. On Taiwan, I note that in every year of the Obama-Biden administration, Taiwan was invited to the World Health Assembly. In no year of the Trump administration has that been the case. And I could go on. In short, I'm deeply concerned that the administration's approach is one which labors under the mistaken belief that just being confrontational is the same thing as being competitive. And that is my question, in fact, about the action the administration announced today in Houston. I'm all for safeguarding our national security. I understand the importance of being tough with China. But being tough is the means, not the ends. So while there may be reason for taking this action, and I look forward to a briefing on it in an appropriate setting, I want to understand better not just the tactical considerations, but how this measure advances our strategy. What is the effect we expect this to have on China's behavior? When China retaliates, as they have said they will, what will be our next move? And our next after that? I'm obviously not asking you to disclose specific actions, which I know you won't and shouldn't, but this is not a simple two-step dance. So help me understand where you think this is all going. I ask this because there should be little doubt that we are indeed in a new era of strategic competition with China, and the United States needs a new strategic framework and a new set of organizing principles to address the challenges of this new era. So far, and despite all the bluster, that effective new strategy has been utterly lacking from this administration. One of the core organizing principles I would suggest is the importance of working in close coordination with our allies and partners to develop a shared and effective approach to China. And I have to say, Secretary Biegun, that the administration's disastrously wrongheaded, alienating, and attacking approach to our alliances has been one of the most disheartening to witness these past several years. Our alliances, our partnerships, and the shared values on which they stand, and our reliability in the face of adversity are our special source for effective global leadership. This value-driven diplomacy is one of the reasons why Senator Rubio and I have joined colleagues around the globe to form the International Parliamentary Alliance on China, IPAC, to provide the vision and leadership and build the relationships needed for our strategic success. I know you argue that this president and the administration has been uniquely successful with China, and I know you're good at your job, but facts are indeed stubborn things. Now, before the hearing devolves into a hearing bashing China and the World Health Organization for the COVID pandemic, let me assure you, one, I stand second to no one in this body regarding concerns over how China's paranoid totalitarianism contributed to its spread. But blame game politics won't save American lives. Instead of relying on science and knowledge, the administration has spent its energies towards finding fault and racially inflammatory rhetoric that both threatens the safety and well-being of Asian Americans and further alienates us on the global stage, including at the G7 and the UN Security Council. If the administration is truly concerned about China's malign intent at the World Health Organization and elsewhere, there's a simple solution. Show up. Take action. If the U.S. leads, others will follow. If we leave the field open, if our own country cannot develop a serious strategy at home, others like China are only too eager to step into the vacuum. I know the chairman, as he's mentioned, has introduced legislation today at China. I welcome his effort. As I mentioned at another hearing this morning, I'm also working with colleagues on a bill to create a comprehensive China strategy, cross-cutting jurisdictions beyond, including this committee, including trade and economic issues and investments here at home, which we plan to shortly introduce. Given the shortcomings of the president's bluster and tactics but no strategy approach to China, a comprehensive and integrated approach is needed. I suspect there will be many areas of agreement between my bill and the chairman's, and so I look forward to working with him on a combined approach. And it is in this spirit, Mr. Secretary, that I implore you today to engage beyond this hearing in a genuine conversation with us about how we work together to develop a comprehensive approach to China, to reset our strategy and our diplomacy, to reinvest and replenish the sources of national strength and competitiveness at home, to place our partnerships and allies first. That reflects our fundamental values as Americans. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Menendez. I think in comparing our two statements, we have much to agree on. And overall, I think we both agree that this comprehensive strategy is needed as we go forward. And I can assure you, when you do get that briefing on the closing, I'm certain you will agree that the closing was appropriate under the circumstances. So with that, I'm going to turn to our witness. The Honorable Stephen Biegun was sworn in as Deputy Secretary of State in December 2019. Immediately prior, he served as U.S. Special Representative for North Korea. Mr. Biegun has 3 decades of experience serving in both the executive and legislative branches, including a stint as Chief of Staff for the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. Deputy Biegun, we appreciate your being here today and invite you to have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Senator Menendez. If I may ask for my full statement to be submitted to the record, I'd like to give a shorter version in order to leave maximum time for members' questions today.
That's certainly agreeable, and we will include your full statement in the record.
Again, thank you both for the invitation to testify today. It truly is a pleasure, and I'm pleased to be back. As you both pointed out, this is an important moment in U.S.-China relations, and the Secretary and I appreciate your serious focus and that of the whole committee in trying to shape a bipartisan approach to this vital policy matter. We recognize that to be successful, U.S. policy towards the PRC must be grounded in consensus across our governing institutions and across our society. Mr. Chairman, for this reason, we welcome the legislation you introduced today, and Senator Menendez, we look forward to seeing yours as well. These are designed to frame the U.S. strategic approach towards the PRC, and this, along with all the other recent legislation passed by the Congress, have provided us with crucial tools to advance our policies against the challenges that we face. Across multiple administrations, the United States has supported China's entry into the rules-based international order in hopes that China would be a partner in upholding international law, norms, and institutions, and that the United States and China could develop a friendly relationship with reciprocal benefit. Over more than 3 decades, U.S. policies towards the PRC have advanced that goal through a massive outpouring of international assistance and lending, through foreign investment, facilitation of Chinese membership in global institutions, and the education of millions of China's brightest scholars at our best universities. Where this administration diverges from previous administrations is in the will to face the uncomfortable truth in U.S.-China relations, that the policies of the past 3 decades simply have not produced the outcomes for which so many had hoped, and that the United States must take decisive action to counter the PRC at this moment. As stated in the 2017 National Security Strategy, despite the huge dividends to the PRC in terms of prosperity, trade, and global influence that the United States supported and its engagement had delivered, Beijing has instead chosen to take increasingly a hard line and aggressive actions, both at home and abroad. And China has emerged as a strategic competitor to the United States and to the rules-based global order. We find the China-U.S. relationship today weighed down by a growing number of disputes, including commercial espionage and intellectual property theft from American companies, unequal treatment of our diplomats, businesses, NGOs, and journalists by Chinese authorities, and abuse of the United States' academic freedom and welcoming posture towards international students to steal sensitive technology and research from our universities in order to advance the PRC's military capabilities. It is these factors which has led the President to direct a number of actions in response, including yesterday's notification to the PRC that we have withdrawn our consent for the PRC to operate its consulate in Houston, Texas. There's also growing alarm around the world about the dismantling of Hong Kong's autonomy, liberty, and democratic institutions, the arbitrary mass detentions and other human rights abuses in Xinjiang, efforts to eliminate Tibetan identity, military pressure against Taiwan, and the assertion of unfounded maritime claims in the South China Sea. Other areas of concern include China's increasingly assertive use of military and economic coercion and state-sponsored disinformation campaigns, including, among others, against India, Australia, Canada, the UK ASEAN members, the European Union, and several other European countries. At the Department of State, both Secretary Pompeo and I are involved day-to-day in the full range of policy matters related to the PRC, an issue that touches upon every dimension of the Department of State's work. The Department has launched a number of diplomatic and economic policy initiatives described in more detail in my written testimony to uphold and defend our interests and those of our friends and allies in areas such as global infrastructure development, market access, and telecommunications security. Much of what we are doing would serve our global interests under any circumstances, but the unfortunate trends we see in China make our actions all the more urgent. We have organized internally through the leadership of the Assistant Secretary of State for East Asia and the Pacific, along with the Directors of Policy Planning and our Global Engagement Center, to align internal policymaking in virtually every single bureau and office in the department. We are likewise organizing our diplomats to focus on competition with China around the world. As part of a comprehensive approach, we are engaged with allies and partners in the G7, the G20, and NATO to highlight the threat that the PRC poses not just to the United States' interests, but also the interests of our allies and partners. We are broadening partnerships across the transatlantic community, the Indo-Pacific, the Middle East, Africa, and the Western Hemisphere. Across the Indo-Pacific region, the United States is deepening relationships with the countries that share our values and interests in a free and open Indo-Pacific. Last September, we held a ministerial-level meeting of the United States, Australia, India, and Japan, marking a new milestone in our diplomatic engagement in a new Asian quad in the region. We are enhancing our alliances with Australia, Japan, the Republic of Korea, the Philippines, and Thailand, which have helped sustain peace and security for generations, and we are furthering our cooperation with ASEAN, an organization central to a free and open Indo-Pacific. Our security assistance to South China Sea claimant states and our recent rejection of the PRC's maritime claims helps partners protect their autonomy and maritime resources. We are working with the Mekong countries to ensure sustainable development and energy security, and we have doubled development assistance to our Pacific Island partners through the Pacific Pledge. On the other side of the world, China has increasingly become a topic of transatlantic and Five Eye discussions. The Secretary recently announced that the United States has accepted the EU's proposal to create a US-EU dialogue on China to discuss our common concerns about the threats that the PRC poses to our shared democratic values. Similarly, the PRC is a core component of our security dialogues with the United Kingdom, Australia, New Zealand, and Canada. In our hemisphere, the United States is working with neighbors to reaffirm the region's long-standing dedication to free societies and free markets. We are working on improving the investment climate for all types of infrastructure, including energy, airports, ports, roads, telecom, and digital networks. In addition to USAID development and humanitarian assistance, we expect the United States International Development Finance Corporation to deploy $12 billion to the Western Hemisphere in the coming years, all towards this effort of making a priority of promoting transparency and privacy, in particular in the digital economy. Though the PRC has made extensive inroads across Africa over the past decade, encouragingly, some African governments have begun to monitor Chinese projects, require Chinese firms to employ more African labor, and demand protection of Africa's fragile ecosystems. Our diplomatic engagement on the continent will continue to highlight the perils of opaque and unsustainable PRC lending practices. In the Middle East, we have successfully engaged with partners to recognize the core costs that come with certain commercial engagements with the PRC, especially telecommunications infrastructure. And finally, we're working with allies and partners to prevent the PRC from undermining international organizations through undue influence. Mr. Chairman, consistent with the priorities of your legislation, I should also underscore that engagement between the United States and China remains of central importance in managing tensions and exploring areas of mutual interest where efforts might align. But we will only make a difference if our engagement produces real progress on the many issues that I've enumerated today. Last month, I joined Secretary Pompeo in Hawaii to meet with our Chinese counterparts. In the two-day discussion, the Secretary stressed that deeds, not words, were the pathway to achieve mutual respect and reciprocity between our countries across commercial, security, diplomatic, and people-to-people interactions. He made clear our determination to push back against Beijing's efforts to undermine democratic norms, challenge the sovereignty of our friends and allies, and engage in unfair trade practices. But at the same time, he outlined areas where the United States and the PRC could cooperate to solve global challenges. Among the issues that we could start with are strategic stability around nuclear capabilities and doctrine, coordinated efforts to identify the origins and spread of COVID-19, a denuclearized North Korea that ensures peace and stability for all who live on the Korean Peninsula, peace building in Afghanistan, international narcotics production and trafficking, and as evidenced by the Phase One trade deal earlier this year, balanced and reciprocal economic policies that will benefit both countries. The United States also welcomes people-to-people exchanges, including the hosting of each other's students, provided that they are here exclusively for the purpose of study. We would also welcome members of Congress from both sides of the Capitol and both sides of the aisle to not only work in partnership with the executive branch, but to also extend your own engagement to better understand the aspirations of the Chinese people. Of course, this includes meeting with your Chinese government counterparts, but it must also include reaching out to the many voices of China that are found outside of China, those not free to be heard at home and therefore requiring our assistance to be heard. Let me be clear. The United States supports the aspirations of those Chinese people who seek to live in peace, prosperity, and freedom. Secretary Pompeo has met with pro-democracy leaders from Hong Kong, with Chinese dissidents and survivors of repression in Xinjiang, and last month I was honored to present the International Women of Courage Award to the mothers of Tiananmen. The bravery of many Chinese people who seek to advance human rights and universal freedoms inspires us all in our work. Mr. Chairman, we are urgently taking the necessary steps to defend the interests of the United States. As we seek to correct the imbalance in our relations with China, we must address today's realities while at the same time leaving open tomorrow's possibilities. With our friends and allies, we are standing up for universal rights and the rules-based international system, the system that has provided the world's collective peace, security, and prosperity for generations to the benefit of the United States, the People's Republic of China, and the entire world. Thank you.
Thank you. With that, we're going to do a round of questioning. We'll start. I'm going to reserve my time, Senator Menendez. I'll turn it over to you for a round of questioning.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As I said earlier, I welcome the administration's clarification of our legal position on China's unlawful claims in the South China Sea. But as you know, international law is not self-enforcing. And having now taken this position, it's critical that we give reality to our legal position, or we may find that a gap between rhetoric and reality produces counterproductive and destabilizing. So what does the administration intend to do to implement this new approach?
Thank you, Senator Menendez. So as you are aware, the United States had for some time rejected Chinese claims without endorsing alternative claimant positions. But in the recent iteration, Secretary of State Pompeo, at the direction of President Trump, has declared the United States to not recognize Chinese declarations. And in fact, we would seek to uphold the rulings of international tribunals that have determined that China's claims, maritime claims in the South China Sea are improper. You know, I hearken back to 2015 when President Xi Jinping, standing at the White House with President Obama, announced that China had no intention to militarize the South China Sea. Just recently, I typed into the search engine on my computer the words Chinese bases South China Sea and looked at the images of what has grown up on the in the South China Sea in the corresponding 5 years. It's an astonishing military buildup that China has undertaken, and China is currently in the midst of major military exercises in the region as well. They have completely militarized the South China Sea. For our part, sir, we will continue our freedom of navigation operations, which are continuing on an ongoing basis. We are providing assistance, including security assistance, to many of our friends and allies in the region. We are making this a subject of discussion in our alliance relationships in the region, not just the South China Sea, I might add, but the East Sea as well, where there are also Chinese claims on the territory of other countries. We are providing substantial security assistance to many of our partners in the region, and we're working very hard to find a common position with our friends and allies in the region, most recently successfully overcoming some of the differences we had with the government of Philippines in order to reach common cause with the Philippines as well as with many other countries in ASEAN to push back decisively against China's claims.
Thank you very much. Well, so I'm looking forward to hearing a further discussion of what are the consultations you've had with partners and allies on their statements and actions. You just mentioned the Philippines as one. As you know, Secretary, the CCP's so-called national security law for Hong Kong, which undermines Hong Kong's autonomy, encourages the crackdown on pro-democracy protesters, and effectively ends its one country, two systems policy, recently went into effect. Along with my colleagues on both sides of this dais, I introduced the Hong Kong Safe Harbor Act, which would provide those Hong Kongers who peacefully protested Beijing's corrupt justice system and could have a well-founded fear of persecution to be eligible for priority two refugee status. What efforts, other than some harsh words and criticism aimed at the CCP for their erosion of Hong Kong's autonomy, is the State Department actively pursuing?
So, Senator Menendez, as you are probably aware, we have used the existing authorities we have in the Department of State under the Immigration and Naturalization Act to impose visa restrictions against some of the leading actors who have played a role in imposing the National Security Act upon the people of Hong Kong in order to strip them of their democracy. Likewise, we have suspended the extradition treaty that we had with Hong Kong in recognition of the fact that the rule of law is unlikely to be found any further under the legislative authorities that the Chinese put in place. We are comprehensively reviewing benefits that are extended to the region of Hong Kong to assess whether or not those should be continued. They're not in a single place in law. They're sprinkled across U.S. code, and we're taking a comprehensive look at all those benefits as we go forward. And finally, as you may know, the president has also extended refugee quota to any travelers coming out of Hong Kong who are fleeing the repression there. Secretary had a chance himself to meet with Joshua Wong in London just yesterday, where he had a good discussion about the current state of affairs in Hong Kong. We will continue to press very hard in order to preserve the democratic voice of the people of Hong Kong.
Well, I hope the refugee status that the legislation that we have a bipartisan support for is something the administration will support. Final question. We have seen authoritarian nations such as China and Russia utilizing emerging technologies in new ways to surveil and repress both domestic and foreign populations, as well as manipulate democratic election. Now these countries are spreading their models of digital authoritarianism to other countries who may be attracted to these new modes of social control. What's the administration's strategy to counter the spread of digital authoritarianism and the malign use of digital products and services, and how are we engaging our allies in that context?
The same technologies that are being used to repress populations are also used in many countries in the world in order to conduct routine screening and security, and so it's a very thorny and complicated issue to sort out the use issues. One of the first and positive steps we've taken is in relation to Xinjiang, where Chinese companies who have in fact provided those tools to the Communist Party in order to be used to enforce the Chinese repression against the Uyghurs are now sanctioned under U.S. law and unable to do business with the United States or with United States companies. We'll continue to extend that kind of protections when we see these technologies used for repressive purposes, but it's an important and worrisome area of technology and one of many that we are having to grapple with in the world in which social media, telecom, and new technologies challenge freedoms around the world.
Thank you. Senator Gardner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Secretary Biegun. Since 2015, I've had the privilege of serving as the chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee Subcommittee on East Asia, the Pacific, and International Cybersecurity Policy, where Senator Markey and I have led efforts to shape a new policy toward the Indo-Pacific region, including through the passage of the landmark Asia Reassurance Initiative Act in December of 2018. As part of our work in the 115th Congress, the East Asia-Pacific Subcommittee also held a three-part series of hearings titled The China Challenge, which examined in a comprehensive manner how the United States should respond to a rising China that seeks to upend and, no doubt, supplant the U.S.-led liberal world order in their minds. Our first two hearings focused on security and economic aspects of China's authoritarian rise, including China's debt trap diplomacy and military modernization programs. Our third hearing focused on democracy, human rights, and rule of law, values that have been fundamental to the conduct of U.S. foreign policy for generations. Our witnesses testified that we are in the midst of the so-called authoritarian closing that under President Xi Jinping has resulted in an unprecedented and intensifying crackdown on civil society, ethnic minorities, and religious freedom in China. We found that the mass concentration camps for Uyghur Muslims in the Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region shocks the conscience and necessitates a serious response from the United States and the international community, including sanctions against top officials. We found that the crackdowns in the Tibet Autonomous Region are intensifying, while Beijing continues to refuse negotiations with the Central Tibetan Administration. We found that human rights defenders in China are routinely jailed, tortured, and otherwise deprived of liberty. We found that genuine freedom of speech and assembly are non-existent, that corruption and abuse of power are rampant. Just look at Hong Kong and the violations of international agreements registered with the United Nations, and the lengths that the Communist Party in China will go to deprive its people of what China itself not too long ago had agreed to. And now in the midst of the unprecedented outbreak of COVID-19, coronavirus, the Communist Party of China continues to hide and obscure critical information that has imperiled a truly global response to the crisis. This is the China that we must deal with, not just now, but for the long run as well. I look forward to hearing from Deputy Secretary Biegun today and how we can best address the China challenge together. In a series of questions, I want to talk about the Asia Reassurance Initiative Act and what it means to the framework, as you identify in your opening statement. But just a few quick questions. Is China torturing Uyghur Muslim population in China?
I'm sorry, Senator, could you repeat the question?
Is China torturing Uyghur Muslims in China?
We certainly believe that there is a severe mistreatment. In fact, we and many other countries are demanding access to Xinjiang and to the
You're not willing to say whether or not they're torturing?
I don't have, torture is a legal definition, and I don't simply have the evidence available to me to make that statement as a legal matter. I do believe they are severely mistreating those people, and it possibly
And you would agree there have been public reports that Uyghur populations have been tortured?
I certainly find it believable, sir.
Is China disappearing scientists and dissidents? Scientists dealing with the coronavirus, dissidents speaking out against Chinese repression?
China has been arresting dissenting voices for my entire career, but in recent months, we have seen, in particular, this focus has turned against those who spoke up, particularly early on, regarding the COVID virus in Wuhan. Absolutely.
Is China stealing U.S. coronavirus research?
As the Department of Justice unveiled in two of its indictments yesterday, we have firm evidence to suggest that Chinese hackers working in close association with Chinese national security institutions have, in fact, been trying to steal information related to the development of technologies to treat the coronavirus.
Is China breaking the Rose Garden promise of no militarization of the South China Seas?
As I mentioned in my earlier comments, one only need to type into your search engine on your computer, South China Sea military bases, and you will see how substantial China has broken the pledge that President Xi Jinping made to President Obama.
Is China persecuting other religious minorities like Christians?
Absolutely.
Is China breaking international agreements in Hong Kong?
They have broken their international agreement in Hong Kong.
This obviously is something that must be dealt with swiftly, strongly, and not just by the United States, but the global condemnation and action subsequent to that condemnation that will show China and the Communist Party of China that their actions are unacceptable of a responsible if they wish to be deemed or seen as a responsible nation. The Asia Reassurance Initiative Act, which passed in 2018, sets a framework. In your testimony, you state that the Asia Reassurance Initiative Act is a framework for U.S. leadership in the Indo-Pacific. It's based on the National Defense Strategy, National Security Strategy. Just out of curiosity, how can we use ARIA, that framework, to address the challenges and the consequences of the actions China's taken as it relates to the questions you just answered?
Yeah. Similar to what we welcome in Chairman Risch's legislation, laying out a strategic framework and knowing that it is creating a space for us to make proposals here to Capitol Hill on budgets and priorities is very helpful. The authorizing committees do play an important role in telegraphing to the entire department set of professionals the space that we can move into as we go annually through our budgets and staffing issues. Your legislation, which has already been in place for several years, was very useful in that regard. We've seen a complete reorientation of U.S. foreign policy towards Asia-Pacific, consistent and even in some ways through the openings that were suggested in the ARIA legislation. The more focused efforts on China are going to likewise need close congressional and executive cooperation, Senator. And I want to thank you and the members of the committee for a number of pieces of legislation that I highlight in my written testimony that have come out in recent years. Senator Risch, if I may also for a moment, I misspoke a moment ago. It wasn't Joshua Wong that the Secretary met with. It was another brave democracy activist named Nathan Law that he met with in London yesterday. And I just wanted to correct
that
for the record.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Gardner. Senator Cardin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Secretary Biegun, thank you for your service. We appreciate it very much. There's a common theme from all of us. We get 5 minutes, and we can't list all of our concerns about China in 5 minutes. There's so many issues of major concern. But I want to follow up on Senator Gardner's point that we need a global response, at least a regional response. And the Trump administration, one of the first policies it initiated was to pull out of the TPP, Trans-Pacific Partnership, which was a trading bloc that was to stand up in some respects against the economic power of China on a regional basis. The president then initiated trade policy talks with China that were unilateral with the United States and China, not engaging our other trading partners. And as those discussions have taken place, it's becoming a concern to many of our trading partners that the United States is looking for an agreement where
Yep, you hear a camera mic, but we'll give you a podium mic, and I'll verify. And this,